Okay, well, thank you. So first I would like to thank the organizers for giving me this chance. Okay, so I want to talk about something called like semi-groups. This is not very common in physics, but I'll try to convince you why this should be common. Okay, so this is some work which I did with Daniel Teixeira, Diego Trancanelli, there in Sao Paulo, and Professor Sugino and Corapin are here. Okay, so this is the outline of my talk. So first, I will introduce what these semi-groups are, and then I'll focus on one particular kind of semi-groups, which are known as inverse semi-groups. Okay, and then I will show how to use these semi-groups to formulate supersymmetric quantum mechanics. Okay, and then I'll build integrable Xusi spin chains. So by now you have already heard enough supersymmetry from other talks, like earlier today in the morning and Hoshio Katsura's talk. So I will be able to go through this faster, but this is slightly different. And then I will show you how we can have a modified version of the Motzkin and Fredkin spin chain, which you heard again from Hoshio Katsura's talk and Professor Korapin's talk yesterday. And I will show how to give like a semi-group twist to this. Okay, so I start with what a semi-group is. So initially it may seem abstract, but I will give you enough motivation for this. So if you take a group, that's a set which has an associative binary operation, right? And every element has an inverse, and there is a unique identity in a group. But in a semi-group, it is again a set. It has an associative binary operation, but it generalizes groups in the sense that the elements like don't have to have inverses. Okay, so in particular, this means that I can have product of two elements, and they may be like zero, which is not possible in a group. And I'll give you why, and I'll tell you why this is something which you should expect. Because if you take, so imagine you take the sphere like S2. Now SO3 acts on the sphere, right? And I can do all operations on the sphere, like on SO3. So I can do, so any two operations are composable. I can do compositions between any two operations. But if you take a finite space, in a finite space, all operations are not possible. So sometimes I cannot do some operations. So for that, so we have to generalize the notion of these groups for that. Okay, so semi-groups is one way of doing it, and it generalizes to something more general known as groupoids. So groupoids are categories. I won't talk about that here. Okay, so but now I have to tell you what is an inverse semigroup. So far I told you what is a semigroup. So an inverse semigroup, it introduces a notion of a unique inverse to every element in the set. Okay, so here if I choose some element X, then I can have this element Y to be the inverse of X in the following way. So if you just read this as X inverse, so X inverse X is X inverse X inverse is X inverse. So now X and Y are unique inverses to each other. So now you may immediately ask, so why is this not a group? So difference comes in the following way. So I don't have a single identity element now. I have several identities. So they are like partial identities. Okay. So again, to give more physical motivation, so just like how crystals are classified by the finite groups, you can classify the quasi-crystals. Like this is an example of this Penrose tiling. So this Penrose tiling has as its symmetry some inverse semigroup. So studying the quasi-crystals, like studying the motion of some, say, an electron on a quasi-crystal field, like a background, you should actually do, I mean, the proper way to do would be to have your Hamiltonian to be invariant under some inverse semigroup. Yeah. I don't remember, sorry. Yeah. Okay, I'll tell you. Yeah, so, I mean, so this classification is not complete. So otherwise, you will know all the quasi-crystals. But so some works have been there along this direction. But I am not going to talk anything about these right now. I'm going to use these semi-groups in completely completely like a different context. So now I'll introduce what are known as symmetric inverse semi groups. So just like how you have the like permutation groups in the group theory, you have an analogous object called the symmetric inverse semi group in semi group theory. So how do you construct this symmetric inverse semi group? Okay, so you start. So just like how permutation groups acts on a finite set of order n, again the symmetric inverse semi group also acts on this finite set of order n. So as I told you like previously, this so the semi group, we expect it not to act on the entire set. It only acts on a finite subset of this. Okay, so then we consider all the partial like functions on this set. Okay, so our initial set has order n, and then we choose a subset which has order p, which is smaller than n. Now the elements of the symmetric inverse semi group act on this act on these finite subsets. Okay, so it might be abstract now. I'll soon give you examples in terms of like pictures and so on, so it'll become much clearer. Okay, so for an example, we can consider the initial set to have order 2, and then I take my subset can only be of order 1. Okay, so now I have four kinds of elements which I can write, which I call x11, x12, x21, and x22. So x11 means the element, the function, or the partial function x11 acts only on the object 1, and it takes you to object 1. It does not act on object 2. Same way, this acts on object 1 and takes you to object 2. Okay. And the composition rule is the following. So xij times xkl is delta jk xil. So when j and k are equal, I get a non-zero product. So for some of you, this might be familiar as the product of the Eij matrices, which I'll soon show. Okay, so now I'll show you some diagrams to explain this much better. So x11 is here. So this is my initial set. I have like element 1 and element 2. x11 acts on element 1 and takes me to element 1. x12 does the same for 1 to 2, the 2 to 1 and 2 to 2. So these are the elements of S21. Okay. So now I give you some example of this of the composition rule. So x12 times x21, so I just need to trace the arrows. If I trace the arrows, I get x11 here. Okay. But if I do x11 times x21, I cannot trace the arrows because it is discontinuous here. So I get like a zero. So this is precisely what I was telling you. When you want to have like the symmetries of some finite space, I should not be allowed to do all the operations. Okay. So now I can go further. I choose my initial set to have order 3. And again, I choose my subset to have order 1. I could also choose my subset to have order 2, but I'm not showing that. So I have these 9 elements now. x11, 12, 13, 21, 22, 23, 31, 32, 33. So as you can see, this is just like the basis elements of like 3x3 matrices. Okay. So if I have S 3, 3, which means I have to act on all the three elements. So I will go back to the S3 permutation group. Okay. So now we can as I kept alluding to, we can have a matrix representation for all the elements of S21 and S31, and it is precisely the Eij matrices. So X11 is just this, X12 is this, X21 is this, and X22 is this. So as you can see now, X11 plus X22 is identity, but X11 acts only is identity only on the first element, and same way X22's identity only on the second element. So these are partial identities, and they are precise, and they are projectors in the sense that X11 square is equal to X11. So this is usually not found in like group theory. Okay. So now you can see that I can find like supersymmetry easily now, because X12 square is 0, X21 square is 0. Okay. So now we are one step closer to this Susi algebras. So now I'll show you how to construct the supersymmetry with this. Okay. So now so by now, since the others have already said this, I'll just go through this fast. So SUSY algebra in 0 plus 1 dimension is also known as SUSY quantum mechanics, introduced by Witten. Actually, it's not introduced by Witten. Earlier, Nicolai also had it, like in a statistical mechanics setting. So which is what they are all doing. Okay, so SUSY algebra is generated by operator Q. Okay, this is known as the supercharge. It is nilpotent, so it squares to 0, and the anti-commutator is H. I can also do Q, you can take a Q tilde, which is Q plus a Q dagger, and you will get same thing. H is a Hamiltonian, so it is part of the SUSY algebra. And now, so from this it follows that H is supersymmetric, okay, from this algebra. And as we have already seen, it has a positive definite spectrum. Okay, so now I can use S21 to build these supercharges. So I'll use small q over here. You will understand like why afterwards. So you can take q to be X12, and q dagger is just X21. So it like trivially satisfies the SUSY algebra, and the Hamiltonian that you get now, if you do QQ dagger plus Q dagger Q, you get identity. You'll get X11 plus X22 is the identity. Okay. So essentially what I'm doing here is I've taken a four-dimensional Hilbert space. So I'm going to work in this regular representation. Okay. So this is an operator, so probably I should put a hat. But anyway, so please adjust. So this X12 will only act on these two elements, on these two states. And it will take me to like this sector. And Q dagger will act on these two states and take me to the other sector. It is because this has the second index to be 2, and here the first index is 2. So, okay. So this Hilbert space is, so I've introduced an artificial like grading in this Hilbert space. And I just, so since the first index is 1 over here, I call this as like sector 1. This is like the fictitious bosonic sector, okay? And here the first index is 2, and I call it as the fictitious fermionic sector, okay? So I also have like a fermionic operator. So the fermionic operator, it just says if your state is in the fermionic sector or no, which is just X22, okay? So but now over here the Hamiltonian is just identity, so it is not very interesting. Okay, but you can go to S31. In S31, I have a more non-trivial supercharge. So now I choose my Q to be X12 plus X13 divided by the square root of 2. This is just a normalization factor. And this adjoint is the following. Okay, so now essentially I have graded the Hilbert space in the following way. So X12, X13. So this Q acts on the states which have the first index as 2 or 3, which are precisely these 6 states. Okay, so 2 plus 3 is like my fermionic sector now. Okay, and Q dagger acts on the states which have first index equal to 1. So this, the first sector now is my is a bosonic sector. Okay, but now if you take the anti-commutator, okay, it is also trivial to see that Q square equal to 0. If you take the anti-commutator now, okay, you will get the following. You will get X11 plus X22, X33. So up to this is identity. Of course, you have this 2. But you have X23 and X32. So you won't get identity now. Okay. So what we are essentially seeing is the following. So here, this Q and Q dagger, they are like spinless fermions. So this is just the Clifford algebra. But here, when I use S31, it's not the Clifford algebra anymore. It's a centrally extended version of the Clifford algebra, with the central extension being this. Okay. Okay, so now I have 3 unpaired like zero modes. So Q and Q dagger acting on these 3 states give me 0. Yeah, I mean this is called this regular representation. Yeah. Yeah, I'm sorry about that. Okay, so now I have the fermion number operator. So since the fermionic sector can have the first index as either 2 or 3, so my fermionic number operator is X22 plus X33. Okay. Now the bosons, all these are the ground states. I can find the excited states also, which are which I call the fermions and bosons. It is just like a plus combination of this, and the bosons are x11, x12, x13. Okay, so I have all the states for this Hamiltonian. Okay, now I want to build. So up till now I only showed you like a single particle system. So now I want to build a chain. Okay, so I can choose like a global supercharge. So which is why I wrote earlier, I wrote the other supercharges to be small q. These are on each site. So global supercharge q can be written in the following way. Where A, there's some field in some complex numbers. Okay, so if you want these thetas to come anti-commute, we put a string operator like this, which is just obtained from the fermion number. Okay, so which is very similar to this, to the supercharges which you saw earlier today, and in Hoshio Katsura's talk. Yeah. So now it is easy to check that these two anti-commute. So this global supercharge Q square, it is equal to zero. Okay. So I can again build like I can take the anti-commutator of Q and Q dagger, and you will get a Hamiltonian which is very trivial, which is just the sum over mi plus pi. So which is the sum over the local Hamiltonians. Okay. So now I can build more some other non-trivial examples. So this is like a long range. This is not very physical, but it just couples all the n sites. But you can also build like things which you heard earlier today and yesterday, where you have like these like three couplings, like θi, θi+1, θi+2, and these coefficients can be anything. So I can order. So I can especially introduce like disorder into these. I can choose these to be from some random ensemble. Okay. So here this is just like this qi, qi+1, qi+2, but here I have this hardcore like bosons. Okay, or I have hardcore fermions, which is very similar to what you saw earlier. Okay, but over there you are only using these spinless fermions, and in this case, it corresponds to S21. It corresponds to choosing S21. But I can choose other semigroups and get more non-trivial things. So now, what is the most interesting thing over here? All these models are integrable because they have local integrals of motion, in the sense that all the local like Suzy Hamiltonian HI, which is the anti-commutator of this QI QI dagger, it commutes with all of them. Okay. So you can build like a hierarchy of integrable systems with this, okay? So which is very similar to what you see in MBL. In MBL states, you have such focal integrals of motion. So in fact, in our paper, which is what we did, we actually proved that there is. We proved that there are all these are examples of full MBLs, but I'm not going to go to that now in this talk. Okay. So now, if you want to solve this, system, you just fill every site I with the local fermions, bosons, and these zero modes, and you can solve these systems. But of course, it's not easy. Okay, so now you can actually show that this is an example of a topological phase of matter, and this topological phase is protected by this Witten index. Okay, so the Witten index in these systems is stable. Okay, and this number, it depends on what representation you choose. So if I choose this regular representation, I get this number. But if I choose some other representation, I can even get like a constant. Okay, so the Witten index for the global system is given by the following expression. Okay, and then you can add like Suzy preserving its perturbations into this Hamiltonian and still preserve the same Witten index. Okay. You can also deform the supercharges. I can put like some A or B and still have this Witten index like preserved. So it gives you a well-defined topological state of like a topological phase. Okay. So now I want to show you, which you probably would have seen. So these are some related works. So as I was telling you, like Witten's SUSY, like quantum mechanics, it was introduced in the 80s. But in the 70s, you already had Hermann Nicolai introduce this supercharge, okay, in order to study like SUSY statistical mechanics, and which can be obtained from our formalism. You just need to choose the soup. You have to choose S21. And same way, like all these works of Fenley and Swingle, right? So they can also be obtained, like in our setting, okay? So, but now there are also works called dynamical lattice SUSY, in which the superchargers change the number of sites, something like Sucra, but I mean, of course not. But. And then you can have a look at this paper by Hajime Horiya. He studies this ergodicity and localization in this SUSY model. Okay. So all these systems which I showed you are not ergodic. Okay. So now, like so far, I only showed you examples of integrable SUSY systems, but I can also construct non-integrable SUSY systems. So for this, you consider another grading of the Hilbert space. This grading is an arbitrary choice. So earlier I took the first, the semigroup index was 1. I chose that to be the bosonic sector, but now I choose like semigroup index to be 2. So I choose the new supercharge. I call it like Q tilde. And 1 plus 3 is the fermionic sector. Okay. And now you choose like a global supercharge, Q prime, with some invertible operator F. And this Q tilde is any of the supercharges which I showed you earlier. So F is like an invertible element. So I can just choose it to be like this, because the Q square is 0. So I can choose it to be like this. This is invertible. So now I don't have a unique grading, because this F is made of the old grading, but Q tilde is made of the new grading. So since the gradings are not compatible, I will get non-integrable examples. Okay, so now I no longer have these local integrals of motion. Okay, so finally, you can also find para supersymmetry with the same formulation. Okay, so what is this para SUSY? So SUSY can be thought of as dynamics on some graded Hilbert space, right? So para SUSY, instead of Q square equal to 0, is Q to the R plus 1 is 0. So R equal to 1 gives you the old SUSY, but for R other values, you'll get other structures. So how the algebra is different is a polynomial algebra. So for R equal to 2, you have some Hamiltonian like this. This is not an easy problem to find what is the Hamiltonian. But in this simple example, so if I use S41 now, I can grade the Hilbert space in the following way. So I have like 1 plus 2, 3, and 4. So this the Q will take me from here, and Q square will take me here, and so on. And I can build these para SUSY charges with this symmetric inverse semigroups. So I should also, so with this I actually finish my, so I finished the first part on SUSY. I also want to tell you that, like after the 80s, when this like supersymmetric quantum mechanics was first introduced, it was introduced to study in order to check if SUSY is spontaneously broken or not, which was the original idea of Witten. But then afterwards it started getting, it was studied in its own, for its intrinsic interest, because it helps you to solve like differential equations. Okay, so if you have so with SUSY, I can solve two different like Schrodinger equation problems. So if you know the solution for some simple problem, you'll be able, with the help of SUSY, you'll be able to find what is the answer for some complicated problem. So which are called the SUSY partner potentials. Okay, so with this formulation, with using this symmetric inverse semigroup, this whole thing can be generalized. And in fact, I'm not showing slides on this over here, but we have some stuff even on that. Okay, especially in the following way, you can relate two different tight binding models. So take a graph. Okay, when you take a graph, you can build like a Laplacian on this graph, and from a given graph, you can build other graphs like sine graph and so on, and subdivision graph and so on. So, and you will have another Laplacian on these graphs. So Suzy helps you to like relate these two Laplacians. But with the old Suzy, which according to this language is S21 Suzy, S21 Suzy, you can only like relate like two particular graphs. But if I use others like semi groups, I can like relate like several other graphs. Okay, so with this I finish my part on Suzy. So yeah. I mean, computing is still hard. I mean, in the sense that if I take this like supercharge, if I take any of these like supercharges, it's still as hard as your problem with S21. I mean, like your model, it's still as hard because I mean I only know how to fill up the states, but I didn't try to solve any of them. It's still hard, and of course we can extend this to higher dimensions. I don't know if I'm giving you a very convincing answer, but like for now, that's all I know. This is not really 1D. I mean, it's one time. It's because it's quantum mechanics. So the initial motivation why I was studying this was to build a topological phase and also to study some supersymmetric version of this SYK. But before that, like Sachdev wrote the paper, so I just gave up. Yeah, but I don't have the full solutions. I should try with what you have done. Okay, so now after this supersymmetry, so now we go back to these Fredkin and Moorskin spin chains, which you saw earlier yesterday. So I don't know if it's a good idea, but so this is the usual spin chain, the Moorskin spin chain. So the Hilbert space is given by the following, which you saw yesterday in Hosho Katsura's talk. So the up spin is like this, the down spin is this, and this is the flat walk. And the colored case, you also add a color to the arrow, okay? And then you build, and then you project out like certain, like these moves. If you project out these moves, so you can map every state to a like a path in two dimensions, okay? And the ground state turns out to be the one which starts at the origin, ends on the x-axis, and doesn't go below the x-axis. So another way, I mean, like since they have all given their own point of views, let me give you my small point of view. So a way to understand these equivalence moves is the following. So I'm trying to go from some point here to a point here. And there are two ways to do this, given all the allowed ways. I can either go flat and then up, or I can go up and then flat. And same way, I have like these two moves, okay. So now I am projecting out all these states, okay. So you see these projectors here. So how do you build this ground state, okay? So to build a ground state, you start with something called a seed state. So the seed state is the all flat configuration, okay? Like how many other steps you have. So the seed state is all flat. And then this is these local moves is like gauge theory. You apply all possible like gauge transformations on these moves, on this state. This is like the seed state, okay? This is precisely like how you construct like the toric code ground state, for example, okay? So you expect these operators to have some algebra, okay? And we computed that it's not published, but this algebra is this temporary Lie algebra. So you can think of this as a gauge theory based on temporary Lie algebras. Okay. So that's my small contribution. So, and then you can see. So as you have heard numerous times yesterday, this has a very peculiar scaling law for entanglement entropy. When you have so for the colored case, S denotes here the number of colors of these arrows. So even if for the colored case, you have a square root of n, That's how it scales. But if there is no color, it is just the logarithmic violation. Okay, this is half chain. Okay, so this is the example of the Moleskine chain. Now, okay, so these are these boundary terms. I am not, let's not go into this. Okay, so now we can also do the Fredkin spin chain, which was introduced by Professor Korapin. So, but now this is like a spin half system where I don't have these flat steps. So I have to do, I have to work on an even side chain. Okay, so which is, this is the Hilbert space, and this is the uncolored and the colored case. Okay, so the uncolored model, again, entropy scales as the logarithm. Okay. So here you have these moves. Now these moves, if you think in like in the language of some gauge theory, it's gauge theory based on some infinite dimensional algebra, but we are not, I won't show you all that. Okay, so these are, so again, you can think of these local equivalence moves the following way. If I want to move from this point to this point, with the allowed moves, I have these two possibilities. Okay. This for colored and uncolored case. This was explained enough by Hosho. Okay. And now you get, like, so this is for any R. This is for any, so R is the size of any subsystem. So again, you get square root of it. Oh, now we show, so now we modified this Moleskine spin chain by changing the local Hilbert space. So now instead of these spin one, the integer spin states, we are using these semigroup elements. Okay, so it's like XAB. So I use, so this is the example of S31 Moleskine chain. S31 is what I already explained earlier. So in every local step, it goes up if A is smaller than B. It goes down if A is more than B. And if A is equal to B, it's a flat step. So now I have several flat steps because I have x11, x22, and x33. Okay. So if you do this, so this is essentially, this is not like coloring. So coloring, you take the arrow, right, and you give a color to it. But here, the semigroup indices are like the arrow head and the tail. So they are like additional degree of freedom on the arrow heads. Okay. So now we have different kinds of paths possible. So only if all the semigroup indices match, we can get a fully connected state. But I can have partially connected and disconnected states. Okay. And the maximum height, like in the Moleskine, the ordinary Moleskine case, the maximum height is half the length of the chain. But now this is changed. Okay, so we were expecting to have some other scaling law. But unfortunately, it didn't turn out. But still, we wrote a paper because we have to write a paper. So this is the example. So this is a fully connected path where I have x12 on the first arrow, x21 on the second arrow, x12 and so on third arrow, x23 on the fourth arrow, so on. So now all the semigroup indices match. So the head of this arrow, the semigroup index in the head of this arrow is equal to the tail of the semigroup index in the tail of this arrow. But now I can, so now I just flip this guy to x32. So I get like a partially connected path. But I can have a fully disconnected path also, where none of the semigroup indices match. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So if you take like five steps in the ordinary Moleskine case, I can go up, 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 up. It's the same even the Fredkin case. So I can just keep going up, up, up. But here I cannot. I can go 1, 2, up, 2, 3, up. But from here I cannot go up any further because 3 is the maximum semigroup index. So I have to go down. I can go down 3, 1 or 3, 2. So in five steps, this is actually six. In five steps, you get maximum height 3 in the semigroup case. But in the scale, in the large end limit, this doesn't matter. So now these are the equivalence moves. Okay. So I have XAB. So now the semigroup indices has to match in my equivalence moves. I don't mix the semigroup indices. Okay. So my Hamiltonian only projects out all the connected states. The disconnected, partially connected, they are all excitations. Okay. So x. So now I have xab, xbb, but now a has to be less than b because it's up move, and a and b is any one of the semigroup indices. Okay. So now, so the difference from the old case comes in the following. So if I have the flat step x11, x11, that can be x12, x21, or x13, x31. So we take a superposition of those. But x22 is only this possible. Okay. x33, I can have x33, x33, but then that will go like below the x-axis. So we don't take that. Instead, we introduce these wedge moves. Like x12, x21 is equivalent to x13, x31, and x31, x13 is this. Okay. So now you have a kind of like a messy Hamiltonian, but still I show it. Okay. So you have, these are the up moves. Again, they are projectors. These are the down moves, the flat moves. These are the new wedge moves. And I introduce a parameter here, mu. Okay. So one feature of this model is we have phase transitions without deforming the local move, which what you saw yesterday in Hoshio Katsura's talk. Okay. And again, these are these boundary terms. Okay. So the boundary terms break the translational invariance of the system. But now, like recently, there is another model called the Kaha model, where they keep it like translation invariant and still get like similar features. I'm not going to talk about all that. Okay, so now this is, so this projects out all the like disconnected terms. Okay, and I also project out these where the semigroup indices are not the same at the two endpoints. So this is my final Hamiltonian, and I have another like parameter here. So I have a parameter here mu, and I have a parameter here lambda. Okay, and how to solve this? This is a highly non-trivial problem, and you have to use techniques from enumerative combinatorics, which Professor Fugino solved without even knowing that there is a subject like this. So I think this is great. So all you need to do is build these recursion relations. So now this ground state degeneracy is not single anymore. So I can start with semigroup index 1 and end with semigroup index 1. So this is like the 1-1 equivalence class. Or I can start with semigroup index 1, end with semigroup index 2. This is 1-2 equivalence class. The same way you have 2-2, 2-1, 2-2, and 3-3. But 3-3, I cannot do, like if you do this guy, I cannot do any, the Hamiltonian does not act on this, on all the all flat like 3-3 configuration. So it is like a ferromagnetic state. Okay? So for example here, this is to count how many different ways are there to like in the 1-1 equivalence class. So I can start with x11 and this remaining, so I should actually have a pn11 here. So I should have, so let me write, so pn11 equal to that, okay. So pn11, so if you do pn11, so you can start with x11 and then you have and the remaining n-1 steps, I can have another like this 1-1. Or I can do 1-2, then go 2-2, and 2-1. I should have a summation over this I here. Okay. And so on, x13, x31, x13, and x32. So you can solve this. And you get the following phase diagram. So phase diagram, so if you remember, there are two parameters, lambda and mu. So this is like I can further add a color to the arrowhead, which I have not done here. So this is like the uncolored case for us. So here you have area law for all like these values. And here you have a logarithmic violation if you turn on the mu. But we don't consider like this region. Oh, I don't remember. Oh, no, I have it. Yeah. Yeah, so if you turn on both mu and this lambda, you have we don't have this frustration free this property. So only if I turn on either mu or lambda, I have frustration free property. Okay, so then you can also do the colored case. And this is the, so now you have a transition from a logarithmic violation to a square root violation. Yeah, so we have to like balance the colors. So which we have to do in all these steps, the flat, the wedge moves. I mean, it's like what like Katsura said, right? Yeah, the color matching of the arrows. But we are also doing another thing here. So this CJ, we are equating all the flat moves. So X11, X22, X and X33 are the same. Okay. So now we have a new phase transition. This is from a logarithmic violation to a square root variable, to a square root this violation. This is not seen in their models. So now, and finally, we also do the same thing for the Fredkin chain. Okay, again, we have these local equivalence moves. Okay, but now I'm restricted on what semigroup index I can use for the starting and the ending points. Okay, there is not much freedom like remaining. Okay, and the additional so these two comprise the old Fredkin chain, the usual one, and here we have the additional these wedge moves, and we again have a Hamiltonian. So now we have two parameters, lambda 1 and lambda 2, and again we see a phase transition like this. So we can also do this for colored case, but I'm not showing this here. Now we have four ground states. There is no 3-3 equivalence class. Okay. So now finally, I'll just give you an idea of the excitations. This model is not fully solved, so it's quite hard, but we have some idea of like some particular excitations, like in this semi-group setting. Okay. And I want to show you that these excitations are localized precisely due to the fact that we have these arrow indices or the semi-group indices, and the fact that and because of which we get these different kinds of states, like fully connected, partially connected, and so on. Okay, so now I can have fully connected excitations, partially connected excitations, or fully disconnected. If I have a fully disconnected state, that is obviously an excitation, because the Hamiltonian only looks at the connected part. Okay, so now I just showed like acting with some operator. This is an operator, like it flips x12 to x23, acting on this ground state in the 1-1 equivalence class. So what I'm saying now holds for both the Moorskin spin chain and the Fredkin spin chain, in the sense that is the semi-group version. Okay. So it flips, it brings about a disconnection here. So here you see in the first I minus one steps, there is like one semi-group index. But the ith step it's two. Okay. And here you have this two is a starting point, but here is three. So there is a small disconnection here. Okay. Which we can enlarge. Okay. In terms of pictures, it's the following way. Okay. So this is like a low energy state, and you can have a high energy state where everything here is connected and here is fully like disconnected. Now you can compute correlations between these two sectors, okay? And you will find them to be precisely like zero, okay? And we have allowed whatever operators, like local operators, are allowed in this Hilbert space, allowed to act in this Hilbert space. So this is another kind of localization where there is no like randomness or disorder. Okay, thank you.